Now, we will consider maximum likelihood approach to the problem of blind source separation or independent component analysis. What is the problem of blind source separation or independent component analysis? The simplest formulation is the following. We have a vector of n independent sources, statistically independent sources. And we mix them by some unknown quadratic matrix A. And X are our observations. And suppose that we have T samples of vector X, and we put them all together to this large matrix capital X. And we will suppose in the beginning that we know distribution of statistically independent sources SI. And even we will say that distribution is the same for simplicity. Then, given matrix A, one can write what will be probability density function of our observations, of our joint observations X. We will do it in 2 minutes. And what we will do then, we will say that our estimate of A is such that our observed data have maximum probability. We will actually maximize the probability density at the point of our observation over all possible matrix A. And it is convenient from computational and derivational point of view, use log probability instead of probability, and this is called log likelihood function. So maximum likelihood estimate of A is just taking argmax over A of log likelihood function, where X is our real measurements, our observed data. Now we will develop maximum likelihood function of our mixtures X. And first, let's consider a joint probability of source vector S. Suppose that entries of S are statistically independent, and even they have the same probability density function, Q of Si. Then joint probability of vector X is just a product of those scalar probability density functions because of independence. Now, our mixtures X are obtained by applying linear mapping from vectors S. How probability density function will change under linear mapping? This is very known in statistics formula, and we will derive it now. Okay, let's consider small area in the area of all possible sources S. Under a linear transformation, it is mapped into other area in the set of axes, all possible axes. And if we have some probability of S being inside of this area, it is the same as probability of X being inside of this new area. And it is a very known fact from linear algebra that volumes of those two areas relate by absolute value of determinant of matrix A. So what we get finally, when those areas are small, then probability is approximately as probability density function of S multiplied by volume of DS is as probability density function in X, where X is AS, multiplied by volume of DX. and the relation between volumes we have. So finally, this is a simple and known formula of how probability density function changes when we apply a linear transformation to our vectors S. Now we remember expression for probability of vector X, S, and substitute those two formula together, and this is our final expression for probability of mixtures. The only step before getting to log likelihood function, it's convenient to use instead of A, its inverse, which called W, A inverse, and by its nature is calling separating matrix. A is mixing matrix and W is separating matrix. If we know real A inverse in W, you can apply it to mixtures and get back our sources. Okay, and of course that W is 1 over that of A because of this inverse. And then instead of S, I can write WX. Every component of S is corresponding row of W multiplied by S, and this gives me my final formula for log likelihood of my observations. The only thing is, if I would have only one observation vector, like one sample in time, if I will have several, then they are independent in time, then joint probability will be product and log likelihood will be sum of corresponding log likelihood functions. It's convenient to express probability density functions in exponential form. Like this, e to the power minus h of si, this will be our q of si, then log q of course will just give us this term, and this will a bit simplify expression for our likelihood function of mixtures X. And then again, like already we told, if we observe many time samples of our mixtures, each sample is vector, and suppose that they are like white noise, statistically independent over time, then probability density of all matrix X, which corners are those time samples, it will be a product of probability densities of every column. And so after taking log, we just need to sum over time this likelihood. And this will be the expression. And then one more convenient step. We don't like functions which go to infinity when t goes to infinity. So we normalize our likelihood. We divide it over t because it doesn't matter. We are looking for its maximum over w. So if we divide over t, maximum doesn't change. So then this will be the first term after division over t. And pay attention on the second term. Here will be 1 over t with sum. It's like mean over t, or mean or sample expectation, if you want. This is our notation for this mean.
So it's just mean over t of this inner expression. And this is our final working expression for log likelihood, which we will try to work in and to optimize. Now, few words. Why are we interested in maximum likelihood estimates of W? Maximum likelihood estimator has some nice properties. It's asymptotical properties, I would say, when t sample size goes to infinity. So it's asymptotically unbiased. So I mean expectation of our estimate goes to right value. And more important, it's asymptotically efficient. If we will consider a mean squared error of our estimator, it will decrease with sample size increasing. But it the expectation of this squared error will decrease as about 1 over t. So if we multiply by t sample size, we get in limit some constant. And this constant is minimal over all possible unbiased estimators, and it's provided by famous Kramer-Rao bound. And also very important notion is so-called quasi-maximum likelihood estimator. It means that we might not know actual distribution of our sources, still we are able to recover them. I mean our estimator may be consistent, say mean squared error goes to zero as sample size grows, maybe in a bit slower rate than actual maximum likelihood error would go, but still estimator may be very practical. So in this case, again, we don't know actual q, so we use some nonlinear function h, which is not minus log of q, but some other function. And in their paper, Pham and Garat considered which are requirements on this h to estimator still to stay consistent, and we will dedicate some attention later to this question.